So today we are going to speak about a very joyful pastime. I mean, all pastimes of Krishna are always joyful. And this is also a very special pastime of the Supreme Lord in Braj Dham, in Govardhan Dham. So we're going to summarize actually four chapters in next 45 minutes or so. It's going to be chapters 24, 25, 26, 27 from the 10th canto. Also summarized by Srila Prabhupada as Krishna book. So in Chaitanya Charitamrita purport, Prabhupada writes, you know, one should be thorough with four books in ISKCON. Bhagavad Gita as it is, Srimad Bhagavatam, Chaitanya Charitamrita, and Nectar of Devotion. He says these four books one should be thorough with. Then later in another purport he says, actually if you just cannot read any of these books, become thorough with Krishna book. This one book is enough to take us back to Godhead. It is so wonderful. Janma Kanma Charme Divyam, Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita. And the Krishna book is so designed that it can be taught from a child of 1 year or even zero in the womb, all the way to someone who's just before death, whatever age it is, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90. And I have practical experience teaching my own 3-4-year-old child who's able to absorb all this. So children can do it. So even we adults can take this up, this book. So in this chapter 24, and also this book, Krishna book or 10th canto, Srila Prabhupada called as Samam Bonam. Every Bhagavatam canto, he gave one title, Science of God or the Cosmic Manifesty, the Cosmology or something like that. So Samam Bonam means it's, you know, like the, like in every company people work, at least in the US, we'd ask, what is the bonus? What is the bonus, you know, salary, okay, what is the bonus? We'd see sign up bonus, coming in bonus, all so many bonuses. So Samam Bonam, this is the final bonus of everything in the Bhagavatam, the heartbeat of the entire Bhagavatam. So chapter 24 is about worshipping Govardhana Hill. Just before this pastime was the pastime of the wives and the Brahmanas. Right, so Krishna and Balaram, they were their friends were afflicted with hunger, extremely hungry, and you know the pastime. Krishna sends them to the Brahmanas, and then the Brahmanas reject them, saying we're doing all these things, and then they come back disappointed, and Krishna sends them to the Matajis, and he delivers them. Then they all come to him, and then he gives them his darshan. And then he sends them back. So in the beginning of this chapter, Shukadeva Goswami actually links us with this previous chapter, saying that Krishna stayed there itself in Vraj with Balarama. So he did not move. Wherever he was, you know, with the pastime with the wives of the Brahmanas, he continues to stay there. And then when he was staying there, he saw some activity going on. You know, in any, whether you are a follower of any religion nowadays here in Bangalore or in India, you by activity you get to know, oh, today is Independence Day, or today is such and such a day, or today is so and so day. Just by the activity you get to know something is going on. Today is Lakshmi Puja, Durga Puja, right? We don't have any, we just inquire then what's going on. So, So he sees that there is, okay, all this achal machal, all this moving around here and there. And being the Supreme Lord, who knows everything, he's going to start inquiring, what are you guys doing? Being the Supreme Lord, you know, Sarvatma Sarvadharshana, he knew everything that's going on. So by doing pranams to the elders, and Nanda Purogaman, which is headed by Nanda Maharaja, in that community, he goes and asks first. He notices, Katyata me pitha koyam. What is going on, pitha? I see a lot of sambrahma. Everyone is going here, there, running here, there, you know. How any festival we have, everyone's running around. One is setting up the electrical system here. One is setting up prasadam. One is decoration. So, kis brahma pade? What brahma are you all in? What illusion are you all in? What is going on here? The entire Vraja seems to be in full activity here. So now, just by seeing, okay, they're all bringing ghee, sticks, all the paraphernalia to do yajna, he understood, okay, yajna is going to happen. That also, you know, you just by observing, you get to know. So he observed that yajna is going to start. So he asked his father, kim phalam? What is the fruit of this yajna? What is the fruit? Any activity we do, we always want to know what is the result, right? Even if we come to the bhakti marg, we want to know why we have come to bhakti marg. What is the result of the bhakti marg? If we go for a job, we want to know what is the result of that job. Anything we do. It's not like something unknown. Oh, I'm doing this because I don't know what is there in the future. So we have to know what is the fruit. What are we doing it for? For whom? For whom? To please whom? Who are you doing this for? What is it meant to accomplish? And remember, 7-year-old boy is inquiring all these questions. 7-year-old boy. So, you know, the parents and the family, if you know, our children also think like this, ask at home when we're doing a festival, we are in a different mind. Our mind is so busy. We're thinking different things. Are you go play. You please go play. Don't ask me anything. You go that side, you know. Go play. We will talk to you later. So many questions. That too, if you know children, so many questions. Why, what, why this, why that, why this. So many questions, you get annoyed with children. Sometimes when I tell my child, you go read some book, you know, I want to do my thing, like that, you know. Such a serious yajna is happening, according to them, and he's annoying with so many questions. But then, the people there then say, no, see, you need to explain to him. Because in the future, they have to carry this on. So in childhood, you should not neglect like this. You have to tell. And especially, you know, in children, you want them to take up whatever the family is doing, right? They want to take up the family customs. Unfortunately, this is our situation in many families now. But here, of course, Krishna is not inquiring for him to learn to do this in the future. He's inquiring to end this Indra Yajna itself. He has no intention of learning from his father to do it when he grows up and he has to teach his children and all this. So he's like, what is the secret meeting, father? He keeps saying the word pita, pita, pita if you see Bhagavatam, because the more you use pita, that father will have that affection, that sneha for the child, and he will share with him. Nothing should be hidden among sadhus. Nothing should be hidden among saintly people or good people. Especially, I am your son. You need to share with me. Usually, a father shares everything with the son, especially regarding the occupation. Once I went for a seminar in US, you know, I was very interested to know. One seminar was happening on astrology. So I went there, and then this presenter, the speaker said that their teacher had told them, never learn astrology from a guru who has a son. From a guru, you know why? Because he will teach all the secrets to the son more, and he'll only give you partial knowledge. So that teacher was saying that. So the father and son is that, and that's how many occupations in the past was going on. You know, we had great mathematician like Shakuntala Devi because the father taught, you know, like this, but the secrets were not shared among others, this kind of system. So I'm your son. You need to share with me every secret. What is this you're holding back? And so then he talks about when one gets to know about karma, it is done this way, that way. Knowledgeable person receives the fruit of that karma correctly. Actually, that is one of the things of karma yoga or karma itself. In karma yoga, we have to see everything. Everything has to be done according to a particular time. Whereas bhakti is not like that. Bhakti you can do without having bath, after having bath. You know, bhakti has no strong rules and regulations. Of course, we have this, you know, follow the regulative principles and all if you want to advance more and more. But, for example, Ajamila, what regulative principles was he following? Still he was saved by chanting Narayana. And then he was made to follow further bhakti. Whereas for karma yoga, you have to do a certain thing at a certain time. Like preferably they do something called Sandhya Vandana. That has to be done before Suryodaya. And then in the evening, Sandhya Kala. So you have to see particular time for that. Japa we can do any time. even they do tarpanas for Amavasya or this tarpana or shraddh. All that has to be done at a particular time. That is one thing about karma yoga. Everything, and you have to know it properly. If you want to get the fruit, you have to know that subject matter, what you're doing correctly. If you don't know, if you're not knowledgeable, then you will not receive the karma phala. So it is. So Krishna is saying, so you will not receive the phala. So what is this you're doing? Be knowledgeable about it. Is it from Shastra or is it some tradition that has just come over? You know? And he's asking this especially because he knows the cowherd men are not very well versed with Shastra. They're very good with taking care of cows. And they're very good with taking care of Vaishya Dharma. So is it something Shastra? Is it some Laukika custom? Is it some sentiment? So this is what mainly is going on. Even when we try to share Krishna consciousness, people always share the sentimental customs they've been taught. And sometimes they want to Krishnaize it also, unfortunately. They want to Krishnaize it also. But it's maybe okay, it's a start. Because they have that conditioning. Bhakti Siddhanta Thakur actually says, without lacerating, you know what is lacerating? Lacerating is that barbed wire fence. You know the barbed wire, the fence which has those kind of pokey things? That's called a barbed wire in the fence. Lacerating means you put it down like that and pull it like that. That's called lacerating. Without lacerating from the heart, all the wrong teachings with Krishna, then you have to put Krishna consciousness in, because we have all these conditionings and then we return back to that conditioning. So that's why the more later we take up, those conditionings will always keep pulling us back. However, bhakti is extremely potent and extremely strong, that it can save one like it saved Ajamila also. So that's why the best thing is what Prahalad Maharaj taught. If possible, kaumaram acharit pragno dharman bhagavataniha. That this human form is very rare. So right from childhood, from kaumara, one should take up the process of bhakti. So that the material conditioning does not affect so much, and we are always attached to the process of bhakti. So all these cowherd boys and all Krishna questions, Nanda Maharaj and all these cowherd boys, I am asking you, please explain. So he starts asking them, and then they say we get food because someone is supplying us rain. It's not like we're getting food because we're getting a paycheck. That is not the custom. It's we are getting food because we are getting a salary. We are getting food because we are working in an industry. We are getting food because I am doing IT job now. We are getting food because someone supplies rain. And who is that someone? He's Indra. And in our Shastra, everyone is a deity. Indra is a deity. Fire, rain, you know, every Agni, everyone is a deity. No one is impersonal. That's why we say there is life on other planets, like Srila Prabhupada said. So, he says, Indra supplies us rain. You know, in the Bhagavad Gita, in third chapter also, this cycle of rain. From rain comes grain. Annad bhavanti bhutani parjana anna sambhavaha. So from grains come, we are nourished. And then because we are nourished, we are able to read Shastra. And because we know Shastra, we are able to do Yajna. Because we do Yajna, we get rain. So that is the process of the cycle goes. If there's no rain, what is the point of your salary and big paycheck or big job or your prestige? Many things, you know, we do in society because of social prestige. It's not, if you take up especially to devotional service, you're considered, bhajan karra, he's doing all these useless things, you know, wasting his life. I have practical experience with this with my recent incident also. Because I've taken up this and, you know, I don't go for a full-time job. I was always, you know, in the bigger circle of my family and all that, looked upon as a person as, hey, what is this? He's left job and he's doing all these things, you know, useless. He's just doing japa, bhajana, all meant for old age. But when we came on TV recently, the whole picture changed. Someone I've not spoken to in the last 10 years, you know, contacts us, saying, hey, I saw you've become celebrity. So, you know, it's like how things change. So we always have to stick to our values, stick to what we've been taught by Srila Prabhupada. Whether fame or name comes, we're not interested. We are interested in what the ultimate purpose of life is. So we have to strongly stick to Shastra. If you see Srila Prabhupada also, even before he came to the US, he had such firm faith. He writes in one book, which was compiled later, called Renunciation Through Wisdom. He wrote some Bengali articles when he was before his, I think during his Vanaprastha, I think in the 50s or so. In the Vanaprastha, in his Vanaprastha days, in 1950s, he wrote, "This mission of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, according to Shastra, according to the predictions of Lord Chaitanya, will spread all over the world." He's written this in 1950. Such firm conviction he had that it will spread, and it did spread. You know, today if we read, let's say we were in 1950s, we read that, who knows? You know, we may have that. He had that firm conviction that this is actually firm faith in Shastra is one of the first steps in bhakti itself. It's even in the 18th chapter, we talk about astikyam. Astikyam, Prabhupada translates as religiousness. But if you see further the commentaries of our acharyas, they say astikyam, you know, nastika and astika we have, right? Atheism and believers in Lord. The astika, the believer in Lord, actually means, according to like Ramanuja, Baladeva, all these people, one who has firm faith in Shastra. That is astikyam. That is theism. Not one who has firm faith in someone called God, who they may call someone else. Some, you know, they may make some mad man as God. There are so many recent gods. No. Having faith in them is not theism. Having faith in Shastra firmly, that is theism. And bona fide Shastras. That is bona fide Shastra, which is given in line by Vyasadeva in the Parampara. So, they talk about why we should offer and be grateful to Indra. If you see like that, we have to be grateful to every other demigod. Then we have to be grateful to sun. We have to be so many pujas, how many 33 crore devatas, you know, we can't be satisfying every day. So then Indra and then Krishna then starts talking about the philosophy of karma mimamsa. So, you know, the philosophy of karma mimamsa is very, very prevalent in modern or even from when industrialization started. This concept of work is worship was actually there in the process of karma yoga. So for example, a brahmana's work was yajan, yajan, patan, patan. So for him, that work is worship. But they translated that into going and working in a bank or doing an IT job, doing heavy industry job. Work is worship. How can that work be worship? That work is actually destroying society. So many IT companies, as I said before, they're doing projects for who? They're doing projects for meat industry or industries which propel or which propagate the breaking of the four regulative principles. So how can that work kind of be worship? So he starts talking about karma mimamsa, saying, even if there is someone, everything is a resultant of your work. Why don't you worship your work then? Why should you worship him? Because you are going to get result only because of what you do. And all results derived from worshipping demigods are simply temporary anyway. So what benefit is supposed to be derived? So he starts talking about this whole karma mimamsa philosophy. And finally he starts telling that, Father, you don't need to worship all these demigods. Because here we have Govardhana. Because of Govardhana we are getting cows. Cows are getting fed. From cows we are getting all these things. Because of Govardhana we have wonderful trees, we have wonderful fruits and all these things. So he starts convincing them about Govardhana. There are palatial buildings in the city, but we are satisfied living in the forest of Vrindavana. Our special relationship with Govardhana Hill and Vrindavana forest are nothing more. So I request you to worship Govardhana Hill. So after finally hearing all these statements, as you know, Nanda Maharaj and... Nanda Maharaj actually, when he was talking, he said, "Okay, for today we'll do this puja, yagna. Later we'll do Govardhana puja." Then he still kind of convinces them, no, we have to do this Govardhana puja. So then they all, whatever they were cooking, all the big bhoga, they redirected towards Govardhana and they start inquiring from Krishna, how do we do this Govardhana puja and all this? So then they start taking all their all the eatables or all the bhoga that they've prepared. That too, they prepared such variety of bhoga without any of these blenders, grinder, machine, nothing, you know. Nowadays, if you want to do a chutney, we'll just we'll run a mixie. Or, you know, we want to do a cake or something, we oven, this, that, you know, all these sweets. But we want to do it faster and faster. Everything should become quick, quick, quick. But Krishna is not seeing, oh, he's offered me a rasgulla, very nice. He's seeing how much work we have done, right? Patram Pushpam, in that verse, it comes, prayatatmanaha, how much prayatna we have done, how much effort have we put. Even Yashoda, she was churning butter, you know, like this. How many hours it would have taken to make that butter? They didn't have like a cream separator machine. You think Krishna can't create all those machines? A cream separator machine and then a butter machine. You have this machine that we have today. And then we just go to the store and we buy one Amul butter or Milky butter. You know. So, and then cook and then. So, it's the more effort we put, I know it's difficult in Kali Yuga. I'm just saying how much, you know, love they had and how they did everything so naturally. So he starts describing, and then Prabhupada actually starts talking about the entire system of economy. How the economy system is, the Brahmana, Kshatriya, and then the cows, everyone has a part to play, the goats, every animal, everything is designed such that everyone has a role to play. Even in Krishna book somewhere, I forget which story. I think before the wives of the Brahmanas, I think. Krishna talks about, I think the stealing of the garments, I think in that story. He talks about a tree. Usually a tree is considered to be in which guna? Tamoguna, right? But a tree, he actually praises a tree which is in tamoguna, saying, a tree only takes water, but gives you cinnamon bark, like bark, gives you leaves, gives you shade, gives you flowers, gives you fruit. It takes one item, and how much does it give in return? So many things. It doesn't hurt you. It protects you from rain. Whereas we are complete opposite, right? We take more and we give less. So even a tree in tamoguna sees, look at the value of it. So imagine sattvika guna or the higher gunas as we go, how much value should we be contributing to society that way? So he starts talking about the entire system of economy. And then they offer the sacrifice to Govardhana. So they do with great pomp, with great festivity, they do all this. And when everything is over, obviously he says, I am Govardhana. And then he accepts all the bhoga. And then he says, one who personally neglects the worship of Govardhana Puja as I am personally conducting it, will never be happy. There are many snakes on Govardhana Hill, and persons neglecting the prescribed duty of Govardhana Puja will be bitten by snakes and killed. In order to assure the good fortune of the cows and themselves, all people of Vrindavana near Govardhana must worship the hill as prescribed by me. This is one more great contribution in our Sampradaya by Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Which other Sampradaya in South India does Govardhana Puja? This whole concept, great contribution by Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and Srila Prabhupada, of course, for us. Because of him, Govardhana Puja is done all over the world now, as Chaitanya Mahaprabhu predicted. So when that happened, obviously, someone else got angry. Indra gets angry. Of course, you can't satisfy everyone in this world. And we'll see why he gets angry and what is the lesson he learned from this as we go on. So Indra understood that the sacrifice has been stopped. And he became very angry. Usual saying is, never take a decision when you are angry. Never take any action when you are angry. Let it cool down. Let it take 2-3 days. Because what you do in anger, you will regret it later. Then you have to do atonement for that also, probably. Then you have to apologize for that. In Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, right? Dhyayato vishayan pumsa sang. Sangasteshu pajayate, sangat sanjayate kamaha, kamat krodobhi jayate. Notice the next verse. Krodhat bhavati sammoha, sammohat smriti vibramaha. स्मृति भ्रंशात बुद्धि नाशो बुद्धि नाशात प्रणश्यति. सो वंस वी गेट एंग्री व्हाट हैपेंस वी डेवलप फर्स्ट एक्चुअली व्हाई बिकॉज़ ही गॉट एंग्री ही हैज दिस काम लस्ट माय सेंसेस आर नॉट ग्रेटिफाइड एंड इफ दैट डजंट हैपन एंगर अराइजेस फ्रॉम एंगर delusion arises. This is a very popular verse, all of you know this. From delusion, bewilderment of memory. Smriti Bhramshad. You know, Smriti Bhramshad. The whole, so when we, our intelligence is lost by applying Shastra, we are going to try to satisfy our own ego. We are not going to think in terms of real ego. That time we are thinking, I am the supreme, I am the thing. You know, people, when they fight, I will show you who I am. I will finish you, you know, all these kind of talking when they're angry. Because who are you to finish anybody? You know, we are nobody. The Supreme Lord, you know, is taking care of everyone. So that's a very powerful verse. So we always have to remember, never make a decision out of anger. Even when something doesn't go according to our thing, we get angry, we have to put it aside. Even when I used to get annoyed at work back in the day, initial days, I actually blasted some emails and it went against me. So even they told me, you know, when your thing, write an email, close it, next day review it and send. So then that really helped me in my life. And then later when I read Bhagavad Gita, I understood that even further. So then, you know, he comes to the point now, this Vrindavana must be destroyed in all, whatever the situation is. I'm going to use all my power and destroy them, because they want to destroy these cows, especially cows. Prabhupada writes in the book here, cows especially, because prosperity depends on cows. Economic prosperity depends on cows. Not like today, as you know, just let the stores open, buses run, the pollution increase and all this, and then the economy will thrive. As you know, from cows we get so much again, you know, ghee, butter, this, and then the cow's urine has such a good effect, cow dung has such good effect. So everything is, he talks about how the cows are very thing. So he wanted to finish the cows. I've read, I don't know if it's true, but even back in the day, especially today, Independence Day, that British people, actually they got to know that the backbone of Indian civilization was cows. So they slaughtered all kinds of Indian cows. We had so many variety of Indian cows. They slaughtered all these cows because they knew they wanted to bring their economic system in India. So they also, see, even they realized that cows are the backbone of economic development in India, and they slaughtered all these several Indian cows. So to do that, he calls this Samvartaka clouds. And then he thrashes, the heavy rain, heavy storm. Little rain, little flooding itself nowadays causes a lot of pain in Bangalore or, anywhere in the world now. Little flooding also. So imagine 7 days of continuous excessive rain. You know, nowadays even for us, clothes doesn't dry if it rains every day. And we're like, oh, what? It's raining every day. You know, can't dry my clothes. So 7 days of rain. So upon hearing, so Krishna, as he understood, so he lifted up Govardhana. He lifted up Govardhana, the Govardhan hill. And then, with his little finger, obviously the inhabitants were all stunned. How can a child pick up some Govardhana, such a huge hill? Of course, Govardhana at that time was so high also. How can he lift it like some mushroom? You know, Prabhupada compares it, he's lifted like a mushroom, or how an elephant can carry a lotus flower, because lotus is insignificant. Just like that, he lifted up the entire hill, and Krishna is like, do not be afraid of this hill, it will not fall, come on. And then all the inhabitants of Vrindavan remain there for 1 week without being disturbed by hunger, thirst, and all these things. They were simply astonished, and after the 7 days, then they all left. And all the Siddhaloka residents, Charana Lokas, and all the residents of these different planets came and showered flowers, and they were glorifying the whole incident. And then, of course, Indra then stopped the rain after 7 days. So after all this, then we come to the next chapter of wonderful Krishna, chapter 26, where all the residents of and inhabitants of Vrindavana come together and joyfully talk about Krishna, about what he did. And they're like, yeah, you know, he lifted that hill. You remember that Putana, how he killed? What a great, you know, you remember how he killed Trunavrata? You remember how he killed Shakatasura? You remember how he killed Dhenukasura? How this Yamalarjuna trees he did with Nalakovara and Manigriva? How he broke those trees and delivered them? You remember how with Dhenukasura and in the Talavana forest, Prarambasura? So they keep talking about all this and they're like, this Krishna is not a normal boy. He's of course something special. Then they go to tell Nanda Maharaj, he's a demigod. He's some different kind of person. So then Nanda Maharaj recollects what Garga Muni had told. You know, Garga Muni had said that this boy descends to annihilate the demons and protect the devotees. And he comes in different ages, in different colors, in different times. So he comes in red color, white. He comes in white color first, then he comes in red color, and then he comes in shama color, and all this. So he continues to talk about, they continue to go on talking about this chapter where they keep glorifying the Supreme Lord about all his activities and what Garga Muni had said. And Nanda Maharaj shares all that, and then how Krishna beautifully and mercifully protected them. And how when Indra sent torrents of rain, Krishna immediately took compassion upon us and saved our families. Of course, Krishna, the Supreme Lord, is not going to do anything out of ambition. Actually, every occupation is supposed to be out of compassion, not out of commercial or ambition for name, fame, money. Nowadays, most doctors also, the occupation should be out of compassion, not out of ambition. When am I going to become the administrator of the big hospital or this or any occupation for that matter? Society was meant to be out of compassion, but that's gone ulta now, topsy-turvy. So Indra then starts realizing his mistake. His ego is crushed. So his ego was not crushed by making him read some shastra. His ego was crushed by this pastime. So he was educated. Actually, education, Srila Prabhupada says, education means to control senses, including ahankara, all these senses. Education means to control senses. Education does not mean go to school, read a book, get marks, get grades, get a rank. No. Education is what? Vidya, which we call education, should lead to vinaya. Right? Vidya, vinaya, sampanne brahmane gavi hastini. Vidya, vidya, vinayam dadahati. Vidya should not give arrogance. Vidya should not give show off. Vidya is not to get prestige. Vidya is to develop vinaya so that it develops compassion. In compassion, we share that vidya. We don't preach out of ambition. We preach out of compassion. It's not out of ambition to collect followers. Not out of ambition to get a big name. Not out of ambition to get so many YouTube followers also. It's meant to be done out of compassion. Whether it's 2 people or 10 million people. The idea is to do out of compassion. So Krishna took this kind of pastime to teach. This is the system of education which was there, of course, many, many, many years back. Where gurus would teach their children, not just with books, but with, you know, taking care of cows or making them do a certain service so that their ego gets crushed. So one becomes a mature devotee in all aspects, not just in one aspect. So Indra starts praying, you're the Supreme Lord, you're the spiritual master of the cosmic world, you're the original proprietor of everything. You know, the usual prayers where everyone offers. You're the Supreme Lord of the whole entire universe. And then he talks about in the material world how there's a regular competition between different types of living entity to become supreme leaders of society. How there's all the time competition, especially everywhere. It could be in a religious organization. I want to become president. I want to become a board member, I want to become a GBC, or I want to become whatever different bodies or groups are there, and all the, or I want to become a CEO, I want to become vice president, I want to become this, I want to become that. So how, and he talks about how after desiring all this, some become so frustrated to achieve the supreme position of leadership, and they start foolishly claiming that they've become God itself. They think their experience is so valuable, and thing, and they start posing themselves as God. And believing in these fake gods is not theism, as I said before, it is atheism, actually. And they've become God. And then, of course, and then he also says that, but me, I am defeated and I am humbled. So some people also get defeated and humbled, and they come to surrender unto the Supreme Lord. That's why as we grow older and older, especially when we first graduate from college, we go to work, we think, next tomorrow I'm going to become the vice president of this organization. Tomorrow I'm going to become so and so. Do I want a coaching to become like this? I'm like this, I'm like that. Then slowly we get beatings. Our ego gets crushed. We get to know we are nobody. And then, you know, it's not an easy thing to go up that ladder. And then we become humbled. As we grow older and older and we retire, we become very, very humble. We even forgive anything and everything because of that experience, because we have become nothing, you know. But at age 30, 40, we think we are so great, you know. So everyone, even whether it is Steve Jobs or this man or that man, at that age, when death, especially when death is nearby. You know, 2-3 weeks back, no, 1 month back, my mother's uncle passed away. So because his children are in the US, I was asked to come and help. And he was in the ICU. It's a very pathetic situation in the ICU. 4 cables here, antibiotics in the neck, food pipe, nose, 2 pipes. Pipes here, all pierced, kidney dialysis pierced here. Extremely difficult to see. And ICU is not, you're not going to see any good omens or any, I could immediately feel there's some evil omens and all this nimittas. Opposite to him was a patient in ICU who wanted to commit suicide. So he consumed poison. He actually went and bought poison. And he consumed that poison, but the poison was adulterated. He got cheated. So he didn't die. So he's right across the uncle relative of mine, and he's wah, 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 screaming, this poison didn't work. That became, it was a police case. You know, you tried to cry and you didn't die. So he was criticizing the police, because, not police, he was criticizing the person who sold him the poison. I paid money, this poison didn't work, and all this. So great India, you know, there also they'll cheat you. And then next to him was another psychic mad fellow. So psychologists were coming, and in ICU I'm hearing all these things. So at that time, I knew my uncle doesn't have much time. He developed fever. And in the story of Shivajwara and Narayana Jwara, if you've read that, Prabhupada talks about when you're going to die, especially when you're in that situation, you'll start developing fever. Once you start developing, it's a symptom, 24 hours. Your fever goes very, very high, and Dhammal will become very cold, especially in that condition. So I narrated to him. So of course, then, you know, there was no, some photo was there of Durga and all his family had kept him gone. So I knew, okay, I started reading to him Krishna book, the story of how Yashoda and Krishna, Krishna opens his mouth and shows the Brahmanda. Actually, he's unconscious, he's in coma. When I told that story in his ear, he just shook like that. He just shook. So I take it, it could be my speculation, but I take it, like even when I was reading Ajamila, he also shook. That there were some evil spirits or something coming, trying to, you know, pull him or something maybe. And when I recited that story, hopefully they went away. Because after that, he had a teardrop in his eye. After I told the story, a teardrop came like this and it got dried up until here. Then we had to wipe it off. Then I kept chanting Hare Krishna. So as we grow older and older, it only makes us more and more humbled. And luckily, I was asked to go there. I could chant Hare Krishna. I could chant all these things. And hopefully that saved him. That's why I, after that experience, I just don't recommend an ICU death at all if possible, because the environment is extremely bad. Very, very bad. You know, as I said, these kind of different, and another lady in that ICU there at the end, there is eating chicken noodles, you know, and she's talking about it also. So what kind of pious environment are you going to leave your body in, you know? The best for us is to leave our body in a, among devotees, not even among family, not even in our own house, according to Srila Prabhupada, because we'll have that attachment to come back. Best is to leave in a dham or among devotees. So he talks about how Indra talks about how he surrendered. And then Krishna says, my dear Indra, I did all this to show you my causeless mercy. Imagine what an ego-crushing incident to do this without even, you know, making me go read this book, your ego will crush, no. And then he continues to say, it's noteworthy, Krishna, Prabhupada says, Krishna sometimes removes all of a rich man's opulences in order to facilitate his becoming a soul surrendered unto him. He removes all his materialistic wealth. Yasya aham anugrihnani, it comes in the 10th canto. Taddhanam shanaihi. Due to his devotional service to the Lord, he may be reduced to poverty. He'll take away everything. Like Prabhupada, he took away everything, but then he also gave him everything. But Prabhupada, that wealth which he was given everything, he was not attached to it. He got a palace in New Vrindavan. He never said, okay, now I have a palace, I'll relax here. You know, I want to enjoy the palace. No, he just stayed probably one day, or he didn't even stay there. But Prabhupada writes here, but one should not think, however, that because he worshipped the Supreme Lord, he became poverty stricken. The real purpose is that when a person is a pure devotee, but at the same time by miscalculation wants to lord it over material nature, the Lord shows his special mercy by taking away all material opulences until at last he surrenders to the Supreme Lord. Even in the story of Krishna entering Mathura, he actually gives wealth, I think, to that washerman or that ironing guy, tailor, I forget. But he gives wealth to a devotee there. So he's always merciful, and he teaches us by his different pastimes or different mercy. So, and then Surabhi Kau also was there, and she also offers her prayers to the Supreme Lord. Then the Surabhi Kau bathed Krishna with her milk, and Indra bathed him with the Ganga water through the trunk of his elephant, which is Airavata. So like this, they all please him. They all understand the lesson they've learned from this whole thing. And Indra then took the permission, and he returns to the heavenly kingdom. So this is an incident which shows how Krishna consciousness can benefit the entire world. Even the lower animals forget their envious nature and become elevated to the qualities of devatas. As you know, there's a verse in the Bhagavata, I'm not getting that. Yasyatma buddhir kunapa, is that one? That one, when one takes up devotional service, which is that one more, he develops all good qualities. Bhagavat ka kinchana, that verse, yeah. So he develops all good qualities. So through his pastime, Indra and all these other living entities there, who were cows and all these other things developed, all the animals also developed non-envious qualities. Actually, this is one of the greatness of our Krishna consciousness movement. It is to purify envy, which is the most difficult thing. It is to purify envy. One of the tests of any meditation or whatever it is to see if it purifies envy. And our Siddhanta, our Bhagavata Dharma is meant for the non-envious. Dharma prochita kaitavatra paramo nirmatsaranam satam. And to become well-wisher of everyone and work in a compassionate spirit. So, Hare Krishna. I think I can take any questions. I'll conclude here. Thank you very much for listening, Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. Any questions? Any comments? Any
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji.
Huh? Hare Krishna.
It was a very nice class, Prabhuji. You have nicely described the pastime and why we should be compassionate. And also you explained the real essence of this Leela. So thank you very much, Prabhuji. I have one question, Prabhuji, in the chat window. So I will read it out for you, Prabhuji.
Okay.
Why our Sampradaya gives such an emphasis or importance for Govardhan Puja?
Krishna himself talks about it. We have faith in the words of Krishna, And that is why we are very special. I'll just read it out quickly here. In the chapter of worshipping Govardhana Hill, Krishna himself says, because I am Govardhana, one who neglects the worship of Govardhana Pujala as I am personally conducting. We follow in the footsteps of our Acharyas and the Supreme Lord, because he says in the Bhagavad Gita, if I don't set an example, then, you know, so I set an example so people follow. As I am personally conducting it, will not be happy. He says, whoever does not do Govardhana Puja will not be happy. There are many snakes, and so he says, you know, they'll get bitten by snakes or this or that. Or, you know, they basically there's not much good. In order to assure good fortune of the cows and themselves, everyone should do this Govardhana Puja. The special significance is by doing Govardhana Puja, we have to bring cow. We will respect a cow. For that, we'll maintain cows. And we'll bring in cows. So even cow slaughter will be diminished. The more Govardhana Puja we do, more cows also will get maintained. The more cows get maintained, the more economic development happens. So this was one of the special contributions by Krishna and our Sampradaya on Govardhana Puja to protect nature, Govardhana, hill, and cows. I hope that answers the question.
Thank you, Prabhuji.